afternoon, colleagues. Good afternoon, friends from the media, and welcome to this afternoon's press briefing. We have just been holding our regular, because this is the 31st high-level meeting of heads of UN missions in West Africa. We very much appreciate the hospitality and the arrangements that have been put in place by our colleague, SRHG Zarif, and his team to host us this time in Monrovia. The objective of the meeting was to provide insights and exchange views on peace and security dynamics in the areas of operation of our respective missions and in the West Africa region as a whole, and to strengthen coordination in order to address common challenges in such areas as elections, transnational organized crime, violent extremism and terrorism, security sector, and constitutional reform processes, as well as democratic transitions. And in attendance, of course, in addition to our host, SRG Farid Zarif, we've had with us the SRG of MUNISMA, the UN mission in Mali, SRG Mohamed Saleh Anadif. Also, we've had our colleague from Côte d'Ivoire, the UN resident coordinator, humanitarian coordinator in Côte d'Ivoire, Mr. Babacar Cissé, and of course the other senior leaders of UNMIL here in Monrovia joining us for this meeting. I am Mohamed Ibn Chambers, the Secretary General representative for West Africa and the Sahel. The heads of missions lauded the peaceful nature of the 10 October elections in Liberia. They noted that compliance with the rule of law and due process is essential for strengthening Liberia's nascent democracy. The heads of missions expressed hope that the electoral process would be concluded expeditiously, stressing that legal challenges should be legitimate and in good faith. They emphasized that the will of the Liberian people must be respected. The heads of missions also noted the importance of complying with the constitutionally mandated date for the inauguration of the new government in January 2018. In this connection, they underscored the need for all parties and stakeholders to exercise restraint, uphold the rule of law, and conduct all activities with civility and in a non-violent manner, including in their public discourse. They further underlined the peaceful, free, fair, and transparent elections. They further underlined that peaceful, free, fair, and transparent elections are a prerequisite for peace, consolidation, and sustainable development in Liberia. They made it clear that the destiny of Liberia remains the responsibility of all Liberians, while emphasizing that the international community needs to continue assisting Liberia's development beyond the conclusion of the electoral process and UNMIL's withdrawal. We, of course, as I mentioned, also reviewed other situations in West Africa, but as you can understand, being here, we express our full solidarity with our colleagues who have been working with all Liberian stakeholders, the government, political parties, institutions such as the Electoral Commission, civil society, the youth and the women of Liberia, to ensure that the peace which prevails in this country shall remain and that Liberia will move on to consolidate peace, democracy, and development of this country for the benefit of. So I will end here. We will distribute the statements to you And if you have any questions, we'll be happy to take them. As I said, we have colleagues here from Mali, from Cote d'Ivoire, our colleagues, SRG Zarif, deputies who are here. We thank you.
Next will be distributed to all of you so you can have.
Any questions? So we'll allow the journalists to come up here, please.
Good afternoon. My name is Moses Gazo. I work for LBS and also report for the Voice of America. Well, when statement comes.
Could you speak to the microphone because you
can. We're not hearing.
Okay. I said my name is Moses Gazo from LBS, the Liberian Broadcasting System, and also report for the Voice of America. I'm concerned about when statements of such come from international agencies, it turns out to create some kind of satisfaction on the other side and dissatisfaction on the other side. I remember the statement from the U.S. Embassy when they also stressed the need for living to the constitutional time limit, and also the one that came from the European Union. Now you are stressing constitutional time limit and the process is in court in Liberia. How important is the judicial process to you in terms of telling the parties to also exercise that restraint that the judicial process can go on smoothly? And one more question for MINUSMA. We have Liberian peacekeepers serving in your operations. How are they faring? And what are the latest update about Liberia participation in that process? Thank you.
We have SRS Zani first, and then SRS.
What has gone into this statement is in conformity with the constitution laws of Liberia. Expeditious conclusion of the electoral process is the intent of the law, which has prescribed very firm timelines for each aspect of the process, from the complaint to the litigation and adjudication and delivery of a decision at various levels where the law has invested power to those institutions or expected to be respected. So nobody is asking any shortcut approach. Everybody is calling for a respect for the legal constitutional time frames that are established in your own laws. We have had 20 aspirants for the position of the president. And as you know, only two of them would emerge at the runoff, at the second round of elections, if that is the decision that the Supreme Court would eventually take. And then out of the two of them, eventually the people of Liberia will be selecting only one. So 19 of them would be unhappy because they were all aspiring to become president. So there would be 19 unhappy souls who would be defeating in the process because the people of Liberia would have spoken and would have selected their final ultimate leader for the next tenure of the presidency of the country. Our call, collective call on behalf of the SRGs, is for all to respect your own laws, to respect your own constitution, and make use of all avenues that are made available in the law in conformity with the spirit of the law. That is, do so in the exercise of your legitimate right, and be sure that it is in good faith and the claim or the complaint is legitimate. Don't abuse it just to stagger the process, prolong the process beyond reason. That would cause frustration amongst the people and would eventually probably result in the defaulting of the constitutional timelines. Thank you.
Quick follow-up, sir. Did this meeting engage political leaders in the country, especially those involved in the protest and the election commission, so forth, for in-depth understanding of root causes?
They did not. However, most of our reportings that go to our headquarters are shared with our colleagues because they have a stake in knowing adequately the developments in the neighboring countries in West Africa, so as to always be constantly aware of the potential ramifications of developments in one country over the situation in the other countries. So you should expect all of them to be well informed of what's happening in Liberia, not just through the media, but also through constant reporting from the mission and also through other sources, including observation reports filed by the International Observer and monitoring missions who were deployed to Liberia during the elections. They have not engaged with any local actors, which is not part of their intention. Thank you.
There was a question on Mali, so if you allow SRG.
I speak in French, hein?
Yes, yes.
Juste, je voulais dire à celui qui a posé la question de la présence des Libériens au Mali. Les Libériens au Mali font partie d'un ensemble d'Africains. Au moins, ne serait-ce qu'au niveau de la CEDEAO, il y a au moins une dizaine de pays de la CEDEAO qui ont des troupes au niveau du Mali. Le contingent libérien, lui, il est au Mali, précisément à Tombouctou. Il s'acquitte très, très bien de sa mission. Il est vraiment apprécié et je peux vous dire que malgré les difficultés du climat, malgré les difficultés de la région, ce n'est pas de la forêt comme ici, mais vos frères en tout cas et vos sœurs se sentent bien au Mali et ils accomplissent leur mission dans de très bonnes conditions, même si je reconnais que la situation n'est pas facile. Thank you. Merci.
I'm going to give you an interpretation in English of what the SRSG just said. He said that the Liberian peacekeepers in Mali are part of a gathering of about 10 ECOWAS countries. The contingent, the Liberian contingent in Timbuktu is discharging its mission with very well. It is very well appreciated. And despite the very difficult climate, it's not the lush forest like here, they feel well and integrated and they accomplish their mission very well.
Before the next question, please, colleagues, can you cut off your phones so that we don't have the situation that we just experienced? Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Anthony Stevens. I work for Power TV. Mr. SRSG of OMIR, I heard you saying that the parties that have grievances should exercise the right to good faith. Could you explain what does that mean? And also, generally to Mr. Dr. Chambers, how would you describe the polls, the October 10th polls in Liberia? Were they credible?
Press?
The elections. Were the elections credible on October 10th?
Your constitution and laws prescribe avenues in due process for all those who have grievances with regards to any aspect of elections. And that enables the litigants, those who are complainants, to go and make use of these avenues for the purpose of seeking redress and relief. As you know, a number of political parties in their own wisdom concluded that the first round of elections was coupled with massive irregularities, and there were plenty of mismanagement and flaws in the first round of elections. Therefore, they complained to the National Elections Commission with regards to the integrity and credibility of the first round. And according to the law, the first stage of litigation is the hearing officer's level at the National Elections Commission. During the described period of time, the parties made their case before the hearing officer, and after having received the verdict, the ruling of the hearing officer, and after having seen that they're not satisfied with the outcome, they appealed to the Board of Commissioners of the National Elections Commission, which is the second appellate level of complaint, and they had the opportunity to explain their position, produce their evidence, and try to argue their case in favor of a revisit of the first elections, or in one particular case, further improvement of the quality of elections if there is going to be a runoff. The Board of Commissioners also confirmed and affirmed the position of the hearing officer, declining the petition of the complainants, and that forced the litigants to appeal to the Supreme Court in order to seek redress at the highest level of judiciary in Liberia. And as you know, the Constitution of Liberia appoints the Supreme Court of Liberia as the ultimate authority to make decisions that cannot be appealed anymore. As we speak today, the Supreme Court of Liberia is hearing the case of the litigants. They will also give the opportunity to the National Elections Commission to provide their re-argument and rebuttal. And hopefully, within a reasonable period of time, they would take the decision on the basis of the evidence that's before them and in the best interest of the country. As you know, the ultimate objective of all of these processes is to ensure that the will of the Liberian people would have will be respected and will be the ultimate choice for the leadership of the country. Thank you.
I fully subscribe to all what SRSG Zarif has said regarding the elections. The only aspect of it that I want to comment on is a peaceful nature of that process. And that's because my mandate in West Africa and Sahel is to work for conflict prevention, for the maintenance of peace and security in the region, exercising the good offices of Secretary General in the region. As far as the Liberian elections are concerned, and thanks to my colleague who invited me to be here during that first round, we were very impressed about the peaceful nature of the process. Of course, even leading up to the elections, there was hardly anything to report about regarding any violence associated with it. So in that regard, there are exemplary elections in the region, and we hope that other countries can take cue from it, that elections are not about street fights or violence or loss of human life. And up to now, in the post-election period, all have resorted to legal means to redress their grievances, and that's the way it should be. So we want to commend all Liberian stakeholders for this exemplary behavior, especially political leaders and their followers, the youth, who sometimes are agents for violence and other untoward behavior during elections in other countries. We have witnesses. But so far in Liberia, everybody has exercised restraint. That's the way it should be. And I think Liberians ought to be proud of themselves for this exemplary conduct, which will inspire many others in West Africa. As you know, many countries will be holding elections. And if they see how Liberians have conducted themselves, I'm sure that would send a very good and strong message that we are capable in West Africa of conducting peaceful and credible elections. Thank you.
If I may add just a word to what Dr. Chambers just stated, I would like to compliment and warmly thank the media also for the role that they have been playing. Some of you have been participants in my regular and frequent meetings in the course of which we have discussed the responsibility of the media. a social responsibility towards educating the people, informing them, and at the same time, making sure that the precious peace that Liberians enjoy will be preserved. And I must admit that the media played a very, very important role in making sure that violence is completely ruled out by their repeated calls through their editorials and through their commentary on all political parties, but also on all segments of the society, that for the sake of democracy, for the sake of peace, everybody must abide by the laws of the country and remain peaceful and nonviolent. So thank you very much for the role that you have played so far, and I hope this will continue in the future.
Okay. Thank you very much. I'm Arthur Douglas, and I work for the state broadcaster, ELBC. I have a few concerns. These words you've just spoken, I mean the statement you read, there are words of caution and advice, or maybe warning. If my interpretation is correct, then may I ask whether there are fears that should these processes ongoing now, the legal processes, go beyond the constitutional limitations, what fears do you have? Should the court come down with a ruling that will say there should be a rerun, are there fears also? My second point of concern is you talk about parties that are actually raising issues to do these issues in good faith. I am of the conviction that UNMIL and other international partners have been following the processes very religiously. Do you sense bad faith in these legal processes by the political parties? And the final one is, how would you respond to critics who would term your statement as an interference into the local politics? Thank you.
No, first of all, there are some hypothetical scenarios that you have raised. You will understand that in these kinds of situations, it's better to avoid speculation and get into hypothetical context. So, but regarding our statement, it is one of support to the electoral process, which has remained within legal and constitutional bounds. We have just commended all stakeholders, particular political leaders who have demonstrated ability to pursue all of this in a very peaceful manner, and also the supporters, the media. You have played a very positive role, constructive role. You should continue to do so. Every country is guided by its constitution, which is the fundamental law of the land in each country. And they set time limits for things, especially mandates of government. And it's just prudent that as we exercise due process and respect for rule of law, we'll be mindful also of timelines set within the constitution. That's part of respecting the constitution and building democracy. So as we are all interested in this young fledgling democracy in Liberia to continue to make progress, we from time to time in our effort to prevent worst case scenarios must remind of important timelines set within the constitution for doing things. So we can only remain very optimistic and have a good and solid perspective for this country and expect that things will be done within constitutional bounds. And that's all that we are expressing in our statements, emphasizing, of course, the very positive aspect of this whole process, that it has remained very peaceful and within legal and constitutional bounds. Thank you.
Just to add a little bit of additional flavor to the full and convincing answer provided by Dr. Chambers, The four issues that were raised, whether we are concerned and worried that there would be a situation that would be unwelcome. If we were to be guided by the trend so far, I would say there is no reason for us to be worried. For the first time, Liberians who had grievances against a very important political process have not taken to the streets, have not started hurling rocks at government buildings, have not engaged in fist fights in the streets, in engaging in violent demonstrations against one another or against the rule of law actors. They have also been behaving appropriately in their public discourse. While expressing disagreement with one another, they have avoided, by and large, slandering one another, using inappropriate words, and engaging in character assassination. So that's also a very important element. And if we go by that experience, as you know, during the elections we had close to 650 rallies, campaigns, mass appearances, and only in 12 of them, there were very limited number of altercations, I should say, because it didn't even go to the level of fighting. Only two injuries were reported. And this is new for Liberia. This is the first time that everybody wants to remain within the law, expressing their disagreement without engaging in violence to show that disagreement. So that, based on that, I see no reason for us to be worried. Now, that brings us to your second point, that should the Supreme Court decide to order a rerun, would that be a reason for us to worry? The Supreme Court can only take one of these two decisions, either to ask for a rerun once they're convinced that the first round of elections were marred to the extent that it invalidated it and it denied it legitimacy and integrity, and therefore it has to be reorganized. Once they're convinced to go that path, then the group that didn't want it will be unhappy, of course. However, there comes the role of the leadership of the political party and of the followers of that party, including the international community, to make sure that the same courage that they have expressed throughout this process by remaining law-abiding, peaceful, that same courage will be displayed in accepting the decision of the ultimate authority, which is the Supreme Court. Commitment to that important principle of the law is very, very important. We would expect all parties, losers and winners, to respect the decision of the Supreme Court. We will be also exercising our good offices to make sure that they are constantly reminded of the expectation of the international community. And you, as media, I'm sure will be saying exactly the same thing. This is the court ruling, and this is the ultimate authority. We'll just follow it. There would be, of course, an odd person here and there who would be expressing anger, but then the maturity of the society would be stronger than those agitations. I think Liberia has come of age. I think Liberia is demonstrating every day evidence of their maturity in their strive to strengthen their democracy in this country. Therefore, I believe that even if there is a decision that one or the other party would not like, they will all be behaving in a civilized manner and remain law-abiding until the process is ended. Now, in connection with faith, good faith or bad faith, it's a matter of perception. If a process is staggered and prolonged beyond a certain time limit that is perceived as a dilatory tactic, then the perception will be that this is not for the purpose of attaining a legitimate objective. It is to frustrate the law from being fully implemented. But that's a perception matter. You don't have an instrument by which you could measure the degree of faithfulness and unfaithfulness in the process. So let's leave it to those who will be expressing that disagreement. I call that everybody should have a legitimate cause and act in good faith in pursuing the legal process. Does not accuse anybody. It is just an expectation that I'm sure is harbored also by the vast majority of the Liberian people. The law itself is meant for the purpose of avoiding bad faith activities. So it is also in conformity with the expectation of the law itself. Now on the last point, which was, I'm not taking notes. That's bad. What was the last point?
You just spoke about it. You addressed that already about perception.
No, there was the last point, the fourth point.
Interference.
Was, interference, oh, okay. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. What is interference? You have to have a good definition of that. Our presence here with large number of troops, getting involved in capacity building, giving advice and mentoring, and is that interference or is it supporting the Liberians in doing the right thing? We came here with 16,000 troops. We spent here 14 years. We spent $7.5 billion in order to do things that are inherently Liberians. The breakdown of law and order was a Liberian situation. The breakdown of governance and rule of law in the country was a Liberian situation. We came here to help you fix those things. Do you consider that interference? If we now tell you that the law that you have created in your own free will and you are expecting everybody to abide that, if we tell you to respect the law, would that be interference? And do you also think that it would be interference if we tell you that all the investments that you have made throughout these years and all the investments we as the international community have done in bringing Liberia from its immediate past conflict to where it is today, would it be interference for us to tell you to sustain this, preserve it and build on it? Don't allow the country to slip back into a conflict. Don't give up on your insistence on the law, on due process. Would that be interference? And where did we say anything that would go beyond that, beyond the call of your own constitution? Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. My name is William Hammond, and I come from the Daily Observer newspaper. Dr. Chimber, in your statement, which many will celebrate, you stress the issue of the will of the people, and that we are having a situation in which the will of the people is so difficult to determine because the result has been challenged because of interference and manipulations and some could say fraud. If you were to choose between the constitutional time and the resounding meaning of the will of the people, which one would you consider?
I would choose due process and respect for constitution of this country. Exactly what is unfolding before our eyes, which we have commended, and I would just urge that you continue to maintain the peaceful atmosphere that is prevailing in Liberia and try to do all of that respecting timelines that have been set in your own constitution, and which a colleague has just reminded you was drafted by Liberian people. Now, I should also add a regional dimension to this. These elections in Liberia, probably in the last 2-3 years, the 10th or the 11th elections, what we begin to witness in West Africa is a capacity of the region to conduct peaceful and credible elections, some of which have been challenged in court, as is the case here, but all of which is leading to a consolidation of peace in a region which has known a troubled past not too long ago, and which, by and large, is emerging very strongly to consolidate the fragile peace, and the young democracies. That's all we ask of Liberia, that it be mindful of this trend in the region and that nothing be done that would otherwise distract from this progress that West Africa is achieving. Thank you.
Now we'll take a...
Dr. Chavez would not leave any room for further elaboration, but I want to bring in just one additional perspective here, that there is never this question of a choice between the right of the people and constitution framework. The intent of the law is to deliver the choice of the people, to guarantee the choice of the people. The, your constitution is the social contract on the basis of which the will of the people should be exercised. And read the first article, it says, all powers rest with the people. So that document is a product of the aspiration of the people of Liberia. They crafted it for the purpose of ensuring that their will be ensured through the implementation of the constitution. However, this is not Bible, this is not Quran. This is a document that nations revisit time and again based on changed circumstances and their different appreciation of relationship between the state and those who should be governed by the state. Therefore, the Constitution leaves room for improvement. There might be provisions of the Constitution that may have not been adequately responsive to the current realities on the ground, but that is still the law. That shortcoming is still part of the law that needs to be respected. As my distinguished learned colleague, Dr. Chambers, said that we will go by the Constitution, by the laws of Liberia. Why? Because you created it, the people created it. Until such time that you amend the law, that is the only law that we will follow. And that's how the people should seek satisfaction that their will is fully respected and delivered at the end of the day. I don't see these two as mutually exclusive. They're complementing one another. The law is meant for the purpose of delivering the will of the people. Thank you. Yes.